from being in Adam to being in Christ. You're now in Christ. Just like I can't see your naked body, I can't see your big chest muscles, I can't see them. Why? Because you've got clothes on. That's the same with your condition now with God when you're born again. You have now been clothed with the Lord Jesus Christ. You've been clothed. Now when God looks at you, He sees Jesus. He took us from being and walking in the flesh to the spirit. And that's why many times we tend to drop back into that flesh part and walk by the flesh and want to hit each other over the head, all right, or want to do things we're not supposed to be doing to one another because we're operating out of a place of the flesh and not the spirit. I'm not saying that when you serve God, now you're going to become soft. I'm not saying that. What I am saying is that there's a supernatural place for you to tap into where there's supernatural wisdom available. Think about it like this. Why on earth would you limit yourself to human wisdom when the wisdom of God, when the wisdom of God is made available to you through Jesus Christ? Why on earth would you limit yourself to your way of thinking? That's stupidity. Why would you want to do that? The wisdom of God is available here, and then we think somehow in our thinking and thought processes, we can actually know better than God. There's no ways. He's omniscient, He's all-knowing. Goes on, this is a crucial one, from the old man. That does not mean the old, the old man. The old William died 7 years ago. He tries to come back up now and then, but he needs to stay in that place, he's dead. And that's why getting baptized in water is so important, and why every believer needs to do it, not just be sprinkled, all right? They need to be baptized in full immersion, showcasing the old has died, and behold, the new has now come. So if you have not been baptized, I want to encourage you to get baptized in water. Not because I say, if you don't like what I'm saying, you're going to have to go back to the Bible and talk to God about that, because that's what He says. All right. The old man, boom, into the new man. And then the last one over there, Gavin mentioned to us and told us that the opposite of love is not hate. The opposite of love is self, meaning that you only think about yourself. Whereas love, it's about laying down your life for your brothers and for your sisters. John chapter 15. For there's no greater love than this, but than to lay down your life for your brother and for your sister or for your friend. So we've been delivered from self into love. And love is the beautiful prize for which we run. And that's what discipleship is all about. It's about becoming love and discovering not what is outside there, but what is inside you, inside you, inside you, inside you, inside of every single one of us over here. Because your future is not ahead of you, all right? Your future is inside of you. The seed of Christ has been sowed into your heart, and that's supposed to now grow and grow and grow and grow until it becomes a beautiful tree where other people can come and parch and find shade under, because that is the kingdom of God. So it's not some religion. This is what Jesus, this is the good news. That there's hope for you, for your family, for this nation, but we need to know who we are. We need to know who we are. And I know that Gav gives that awesome analogy with regards to, if let's just say you had an uncle who's living in the UK, and he is a multi-billionaire, and he writes there in his will that the day that he passes away, Steve is going to inherit £20 billion. Why are you not smiling, Steve? That's £20 billion. You're going to inherit £20 billion. Now, uncle over there in the UK passes away, all right? If you do not know that that is your uncle, you'll never get that 20 billion. And it's the same with us. Jesus Christ, when He hung on the cross, remember, for a will. When someone writes, okay, when this person dies, when I die, my son's going to get this, my daughter's going to get this, this person's going to get this, this person's going to get this. For that will to become active, someone needs to die. Who needs to die? The one that wrote it. And when that person who wrote it dies, what happens? That will becomes active. Are you guys with me? Does this make sense? I don't want you guys to leave you confused. So that's exactly what Jesus done. For the will to become active, for the testament to become active, for the covenant to become active, someone had to die. It had to be the one that wrote it. So God Himself came and died on the cross. So what could happen? So we could have access again to every single promise that He has for us. Every single promise is yes, and the amen belongs to us. So we need to agree. Say, God, what? You are blessed to prosper me, not to harm me, blessed to give me a hope in the future. Hallelujah. Amen, Jesus. I agree with you. I agree with you. We're all shouting when the political parties are doing, I promise you more of this. I promise you. Ah, yes, give me a t-shirt. Give me a shirt. Jesus is promising all of us these promises. And we're like, this guy's taking too long now to finish here. Hey. But then someone else comes, they start throwing t-shirts out, and they're promising jobs, they're promising this, they're promising that. Jesus is promising you an entire kingdom. An entire kingdom. And one person's excited. An entire kingdom. A kingdom. Isaiah 9 says, Jesus, when he came to this earth, for unto us a child is born, and he'll come carrying a religion on his shoulders. No, he comes carrying a government on his shoulders. A government. So we can choose, either we do things in the worldly way, or we do things in the kingdom way. You decide.